your source for everything paranormal. Para-X. The views expressed and the opinions given by the individual host and their guests do not necessarily reflect those of Para-X, its affiliates, or its sponsors.
Welcome, everyone, to another Wednesday night with The Calling with Kimberly Juarez and I. Hi, Kimberly.
Hi, Jerry.
What's happening?
Oh, nothing much.
We're going to talk gang style.
What?
Okay, we're going to talk gang style tonight.
Okay.
What's happening, girl?
What's up, Jerry?
I don't know. No, I think we're done with that.
Okay, that was good.
So tonight, we have a person on that I've wanted him on for a while.
Yes, wanted this him is on exciting.
Yeah. Do you want to introduce him, Kimberly?
We got Bigfoot researcher. Well, I don't know how we could title him because he's a good, I mean, just a huge Bigfoot. Huge, huge. We got Michael X-Men on here. It's awesome.
Michael, how you doing?
Good, good.
Excellent, excellent. So you're out in the woods right now, right?
Well, where I live is kind of like that. I'm 20 miles from a town up here in northern Minnesota, and right now it's a beautiful, sunny, warm day, and the bugs are enjoying it.
Yeah, I was just going to say.
Yeah.
I had a friend of mine that went up north. He went up to Effie. He was telling me a couple of days ago that he went outside for less than 5 minutes and was, in his words, attacked by those little bastards. So he was very, very, he said he just couldn't believe how bad it is up there. Do you think it's buggier than normal?
With the amount of rain we've had this year. Last year we were in a drought up here with all the forest fires. You couldn't even breathe.
Oh.
And bugs were null at all. And in fact, my well went dry last winter from lack of water up here. Now this year, everything's working good. It's just, the bugs are just, a pain, put it that way.
Gotcha.
But Effie's not far from me. Effie's about probably 45-minute drive.
No, that's not too bad.
From where I'm. No.
So I've always wanted...
a great little town.
Gotcha.
Yeah, go ahead.
Always kind of curious about this. Now, since, you've been hunting Bigfoot or researching and looking for Bigfoot for how many years now?
I want to clarify one thing. I've been doing this for over 30 years.
Okay.
And people up here call me the Bigfoot Hunter, and that's what I'm known as, the Bigfoot Hunter, but I am a no-kill.
All right.
My intentions are not to harm them. In fact, when I hunt, I only take what I'm going to eat for food. So I just want to let everyone know that I'm not out for them, to harm them in any shape or way, form.
Right. No, I agree with you on that, because we're paranormal investigators, not ghost hunters. I don't know anybody who's actually ate a ghost, but, I'll probably be a little hairy,
That's another story, but.
Oh, there you go. Yeah. That's a whole nother show.
Right.
How to fillet a ghost, Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
But, within that amount of time that you've been researching, we'll say, to now, with all the shows out there, and Minnesota being listed as a place that Bigfoot has been noticed at, have you seen more amateur-type people running out to the woods and, you know, kind of disturbing stuff and leaving messes and everything?
Not really. Where I'm at up here, it's such a large area. Just the area where I do most of my research was an old 55-square-mile game preserve. And, yeah, it's just so vast up here. You get people on the trails that are ATVing around here and that, but I have not run into anybody in the woods other than the people I've gone out with who are researching up here. So okay. That's not a problem.
Gotcha, because I know, Kim, you can even contest to it, the amount of paranormal investigators that, you know, come around here and destroy property and all yeah. that stuff. It's just horrible. So, and that's what some of the shows bring. And it, so I was kind of curious if that was a northern thing also.
Well, I've done some Bigfoot researching too, and you can find things that, like, say, if they see sightings, and we've gone to places where they've thrashed places and it's not, it's just not nice. You know, they leave their trash and stuff like that, and it's just not, it's not good, you know. It makes it makes other people look bad, and that, you know, you shouldn't do that. But there are, I think there are some amateurs.
Oh, yeah.
We get people up here to camp, and they leave a mess, but they're not necessarily looking for Bigfoot. They're just up for the weekend partying or whatever, and that kind of bothers me. I don't like seeing garbage out in the woods or cans on the side of the road, stuff like that. You know?
Right.
Yeah, there's even some teams that are up in northern Minnesota that we'll kind of stop right there. Anyway, so now in doing this and everything, now you live where you live at in the woods. Have you come across anything that's like Bigfoot related near your home?
Oh, hell yeah. Heck yeah. back in, I want to say 2008, I moved back up here. I was working for a small metal shop in Nashwauk, Minnesota. And my ritual every morning is I didn't have electric or running water. So I would go down on the ice in the morning, and I had a hole open on the ice. I would get water for dishes and water for bathing with. And I'd go out in the morning before work. I'd sit there and watch the sun come up. And one morning I was sitting out there, and this creature came out of where the boat landing is, walked along the shoreline, and then back after about two blocks back up into the woods going to the north. And I knew right away what it was. You know, that time of year, the bears are not in hibernation. They're not going to walk for, you know, two blocks on their hind legs. And I went around at that time to see if I could find some tracks, but it was middle of March, so everything was melting. You really couldn't see any tracks anywhere. But I knew beyond a shadow of a doubt what it was. There's no. That was my second encounter that I had. That was very cool to see something like that. And then I had rocks thrown up on the roof of my cabin at night.
Oh, wow.
That was another thing that happened. And wow. I found sets of snow tracks not far from me. A couple of occasions I found snow tracks. At that time, I didn't have the capability to cast them. Now I do. But, of course, now that I do, I can't find them. But...
Right.
But yeah, it happens that way.
I have people up here that have given me reports. They've had tree knocks on their property and weird things going on that, you know, are like a mile or 2 miles away. There's actually a trackway system, I call it, that's 6 miles north of me. And then there's another one that goes east or north and south. And it goes actually to the west of me, south, and where I found snow tracks. And I've also, there's people that live up on that line that I'm talking about that have had wood knocks and stuff like that going on. Well, yeah, they're definitely around here.
I'll be darned. What is, there's a lot of people that, Barackman and Moneymaker and Lauren Coleman, they all kind of feel that the ones that do road crossings where people have reported that are usually like the adolescent or the teen aged Bigfoot compared to the older ones that tend to stay far away from any type of civilization because they're curious. What's your thoughts on that?
I could talk all night on that subject.
Well, we got an hour to do it, Sunshine. Let's do it.
Yeah, I mean, in all the years I've been researching and been out in the woods, a couple of times really amazed me that we had the action we had with as many people. And I write it off as it being a you know, young Squatch. They're curious, very curious. And I was actually able to watch a video from the State Patrol or Sheriff's Department video of one crossing the highway. About 11 miles west of me, and I asked if I could have a copy of the video, and he said, no, we can't do that. So one particular deal, excuse me, I got roped into doing a show called All Gas and No Brakes. So I got talked into going out with them. And as far as I know, they were going to do a documentary on Bigfoot. Well, it didn't turn out that way. If you ever watched that show, they kind of made fun of everything. But it did get over 4 million views. But anyways, we were out with that group in particular, and they were practicing wood knocks, and I was kind of in the back of the line. They were off into the woods. I was in the trail with a young man that was with me by the name of Drake or Dylan, I can't remember. We had this creature walk out on the trail for about 30 to 40 seconds. It was doing a back-and-forth sway movement, and then stepped into the woods. I yelled at the rest of the group, get out here. We've got one on the trail. And, of course, by the time they got out to the trail, it was gone. And I have no doubt in my mind what it was. The young guy that was with me freaked out and started running. I had to go catch him and calm him down. He just scared the living heck out of him.
Wow.
But I with all the noise that everyone was making, the talking, the cameras, everything that was going on, my opinion, it was a juvenile. He's going, what the heck is all going on? What's all this noise? I got to go check it out. And I mean, what are the odds of seeing something like that with all the noise and stuff that's going on?
I went out
with Cliff and Bobo and those guys. We did a show, Reamer, Home of Bigfoot. I did all the guide work for that show, and then I did that overnight show with them. And it was a place that I selected. We had, I'd say I had three cameramen on me plus an assistant. And you're talking like nine cameramen with lights and everything going on. And we did get a wood knock, which amazed me. But that was probably more of a warning sign that, hey, there's somebody in here. Get out of the area. You know, that to me is when you get a wood knock like that with them, you know, many people in the woods. So. But there's been a couple of other instances where, too, we had a group of people, and there was like three females with us. And we got a bunch of wood knocks. We got mumble talk, everything. And I was, a friend of mine was with from the reservation, and we looked at each other, and we thought, on all the times we've been out, we've never, ever had that much going on. And contributed to the fact that they were curious. They were young, they were curious, and we had females with younger and that, and they were just checking it out, you know. Teenage guys, you know.
Right.
But yeah, I agree. I agree with you that probably most of the sightings and things that are going on are young ones.
Well, so what do you think the knock is exactly when you hear a tree knock? What's the consensus on what exactly that means?
I've had tree knocks many, many, many times. I've had vocalizations twice. Tree knocks to me, it was an area where I'd go in and hunt, and it was just me and another guy because it was late in the year for black powder season. And we were hearing tree knocks, and it was early in the morning when we walked in, and then late in the evening when we were leaving, we heard tree knocks. And we got out to where we were parked. We had like a foot of snow. We were the only ones in this area. There was nobody else in there but us. And at the time, I really didn't understand what was going on. I couldn't figure out what was making these knocks. Well, later on in life, I figured it out. Basically, to me, a tree knock is, if you get one to two tree knocks it's a warning. They hear you coming in, mm-hmm. and they're letting you know, or letting the others know that there's people coming into their area. And then that particular knock when we were leaving the woods that evening was a knock, in my opinion, was telling them, hey, they're leaving, everything's cool.
Yeah.
They're not solitary. They, in my opinion, they're in groups.
Okay.
I don't know how many would be in a group, but they're not solitary. So they have what they call sentries or watchmen out.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Okay. So, okay, so that's for that. What about whoops? What do you think whoops are?
I'm not really sure. If you ever watch All Gas and No Brakes, they made kind of fun of my mumble talk. I've heard that out in the woods, and it's really creepy the first time you hear it.
Mm-hmm.
When I was up on the reservation about 3 years ago, we heard a, it was really weird. I've never heard it, but it was a, oh, and then the coyotes started going nuts. You could hear a pack of coyotes. Coyotes
wow.
went crazy. And then about 2 minutes later, there was a response behind us, the same type of call. And unfortunately, none of this came out on our recording equipment. We had a connector that was cheap.
Mm-hmm.
You know, good money was not spent. So we couldn't get, we could not get that haul. I'm not sure. I've heard so little vocalizations up here. It's primarily tree knocks.
Okay. So question then we were talking about the coyotes. What do you think they hunt with them? I mean, what is the purpose of them being together? Because, I mean, people talk about that all the time, that you, if you see Bigfoot or you hear coyotes, you're pretty they're pretty sure, especially up north, that there'll be a Bigfoot around. So do you believe that they hunt together?
They don't hunt together. My opinion on that is coyotes will take a deer down and kill it.
Mm-hmm.
And Bigfoot will come in and take the deer away from them.
Okay.
Oh.
So I'm thinking that mainly they're following the coyotes or the timber wolves. Same thing, hunting. I've left a gut pile out in the woods and come in the next morning and it's completely gone.
Okay.
There's no bears that time of year out in the woods. So what took the whole gut pile away in less than 12 hours?
Right.
You know, there's... So, yeah, I mean, it makes sense. You know, you get... A lot of times coyotes will take a deer down just for fun. They don't necessarily eat it. They'll come back later and eat it.
Mm-hmm.
Well, who's to say, you know, a group of... family of Bigfoot are in the area and they run across this. Well, they got food for a couple of days or whatever, you know.
Right.
They're going to go for the gut pile obviously first because it's all protein. I mean, if I was lost out in the woods and starving to death, that's what I would eat, would be the gut pile. I hate to say that.
Right.
Nasty.
You know, the heart, the lungs, everything like that. And it's got the most protein for survival in it. So.
Right.
I'd look for
but yeah, I believe
King.
That they do.
Okay.
Sorry. I should have warned you.
I think a gut pile would probably taste better. I don't know. I haven't had fast food in 20 years.
So I've got, it's a good thing. Stay away from it, dude. So I got
a
couple
questions.
That's
why they call it fast food. It goes in and out just as fast. So fast food.
Yeah, but all the calories and nasty stuff stay behind. So I got a couple questions here for you from the chat room. One is asking, do you think that that they are interdimensional?
No, but that's just my opinion.
Okay.
And the reason the native people say that they change, they shift patterns, all right?
Mm-hmm.
I can walk through the woods hunting and I can get behind a tree and completely change my whole profile of how I look. And they're smart. They're going to do the same thing. They're going to, if they're going to hunt and they do an ambush style hunt with deer, and that's another story, but they'll move from tree to tree or whatever and they'll blend in with what the surrounding is. So it's very easy to see somebody moving through the woods that knows how to hunt.
Right.
And can blend in with a tree or a bush. And they'll say, well, the guy just disappeared. He turned into a tree or a bush or whatever. Well, that's called hunting, real hunting.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I think that's all about. You know, people have asked me if I think they're aliens, and I go, no. my opinion, they're not. I could be wrong, but my opinion, I don't think they are.
Okay.
I agree with you on
that. I think they're a missing link is what I think they are.
Do you think
that
they...
The ones I've seen look more manly.
Go ahead.
Well, the ones I've seen look more manlike. They didn't look like gorillas.
Okay.
Right.
I've seen one at 20 feet away from me. I mean, I stared it in the eyes. And it looked like a prehistoric man that was hairy.
There you go. Yeah, the one I've seen walked like Shaquille O'Neal now, you know,
yep,
not then.
Big stride.
Yeah, exactly. More of a lumber to him and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So one other question. Do you believe in, or I'm sorry, where is it? Are you on a team right now or are you on your own?
I am on my own. There's a friend of mine up in the reservation. He wants to get together and start doing some stuff. And I've had other people ask me if I want to join their team. The only thing I don't like about that is their approach to me is all wrong. If you really want to get a look at Bigfoot or have a chance, you got to go in quiet and got to go in stealth. If you go in
right.
there with four or five or six people, you're going to be lucky if you get a tree now.
Right.
So seriously, right. You know, you got to take up the old native ways, how they used to hunt.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, if you guys ever hunted, I grew up hunting and fishing and trapping. So I learned the way of the woods when I was pretty young. And how I moved through the woods is completely different from other people.
Right.
But yeah, I mean, I think they just simply blend in.
Right. No one's ever really seen Bigfoot hunt for food, right? This was kind of a question in there. Yeah, that's I figured. Okay. Because I know there's some people that claim that, they've got video or they know somebody who's got video of Bigfoot making, like a teepee style out of sticks and stuff, which is, okay, show it then. And
right.
I don't feel you're the type of guy that's going to, if you've seen Bigfoot, if you know where they have like a camp or whatever, that you're not going to be the one that's going to, hold out for, what is it up to now, like $100 million or something for a live Bigfoot or dead Bigfoot, through Lloyd's of London, I think it is through. That they're paying that much. I just don't, you're not the type of guy that does that. You do have respect.
No.
And like you said in the beginning, no kill type,
If you were going to do something like that in a particular area, you would never be able to go in that area again. And I'll tell you a story about that. When we brought the show in Finding Bigfoot,
mm-hmm.
Now, these things have been part of my life for over 30 years. They've been with me when I was hunting. When I used to trap in that area, I'd hear them walking behind me. I knew I was being followed. But we brought a crew of people into an area that's their area. And it was kind of funny because like about a month and a half later, I was in that same area and I started to get infrasound where I got really sick and stuff thrown at me. Rocks mm-hmm. and branches thrown at me. They wanted me out of that area because they were, I believe they were mad at me.
Yeah, that's what
and
I thought
since,
too.
Since then, I've been able to go back in there again. As far as the teepee formations, I've found them out in the woods and I couldn't figure out. I've looked at a lot of teepees and I write them off as wind damage. A couple branches, literally we got struck. No, it's not. It's wind damage.
Mm-hmm.
And right.
As far as the way they hunt, my experience on that is they're in ambush. I've followed deer trails that were blocked off with fallen trees.
Uh-huh.
So the deer have to walk around the fallen trees, and then they take them down when they come into their grabbing range.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason I know this is because I found deer carcasses out in the woods where the back legs are broken.
Wow.
There's no teeth mark. If a wolf or coyotes take them down, you'll see teeth marks in the bones.
Right.
There's absolutely no one. A couple of my phone had no teeth marks, and they were less than 10 feet away from an obstruction on the trail that they used. So they had to go around this obstruction, and one or two of these Bigfoot were laying in ambush and got them, broke their back legs, whatever they did. So That's kind of interesting. That's what my conclusion is of how they hunt.
Mm-hmm.
So. Wow. So, okay. What was my question? I got to start writing these down. This is pathetic. So when it comes to Bigfoot and it comes to, waterways and stuff like that, do you feel that they are swimmers or they're not swimmers?
I believe they can swim because the ones I've seen were more man-like, not ape.
Mm-hmm,
so I think they probably could swim. I've never seen one, of course.
Right.
But I do know they live around water because where I've seen them and have heard them, there's been either a lake or a swamp within, a half a mile to a mile away. So I do know they live around water, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
They need water for drinking or whatever. And I've never seen one swim yet. That would be interesting, though.
Yeah, that would be. That definitely would be.
And the weather we've had up here, I wouldn't doubt that they're in the water. I don't know if they're swimming or not, but it's been hot, so.
Right. Huh. So, when you go out and everything, you don't try to mask your scent with onions and stuff like that. I heard some people do that, because to me, that would be introducing a totally different scent out in the woods that should never have been there. So any animal whatsoever that catches that scent is going to make sure to run the other way.
You're absolutely right.
Right.
When I go out in the woods, I try to wear clothes that are washed in scentless detergent. I don't go out with, obviously, any cologne on or anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
It's just like bears, okay? Bears up in northern Minnesota, if you're going to hunt bear, you got to put stuff down around the bait pit that you're going to be carrying with you so they get used to that smell. If they're not used to that and they catch one whiff of it, they're out of there.
Right.
If you get bears down by the cities, of course, they're used to everything. They're not afraid of nothing. But you're right. Bigfoot's going to be the same thing. Same deal. People will go in and do research. They'll drive in with their car, slam their doors, and they'll go 32 feet from their car and expect to see one. Well, you're not going to.
Right.
You got to go in quiet. You got to go in not smelling like anything. The best thing I could say, is if you wanted to, is basically take your clothes and get a bonfire going and let the smoke get on your clothes.
That's
a good idea.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they're actually used to people, campfires are used to fires, like forest fires and all that. They're not afraid of that.
Right.
So that would be the best cover-up scent you could use, something like that. And then go in with a ghillie suit on. Don't walk in with the bright-colored clothing or anything like that. Best thing you could do is go in with one of those $60 hunting blinds that fold up.
Mm-hmm.
Get into an area. Yeah, you may sit there all day or all night and not see or hear nothing, but that's the way it is. There's no guarantee you're going to see anything.
Michael,
people that when I take them up.
What about structures? I mean, you're saying like they form teepees, but what about structures? I mean, what is the deal on that? I mean, I really don't feel... I would think they'd be more in cave-like areas or something like that. But, I mean, what is your take on that?
Okay. A lot of people claim that they migrate south where it's warmer. They don't up here because I found snow tracks, obviously.
Right.
As far as I know, there's not a lot of cave structures up in here in this part of the country.
Okay.
So my guess is what they do is they get back into the tamarack swamps.
Mm-hmm.
In the winter, because they never really freeze. You got that thick sponge grass. I've actually been back in them and taken a nap on this stuff. It's like sleeping on a mattress.
Mm-hmm.
What I believe they'll do is they'll take and they'll pile up logs up against a tree and make a shelter. And then they're sheltered by the denseness of the forest itself. And it never really freezes to the point where they can be on a soft area. And then who's to say they don't take the hides off these animals they kill and wrap themselves with it?
Right, right.
And then also body warmth. Huddle together, you're going to keep warm.
Right. Hold on to that thought, Michael. We'll be right back.
Okay.
We've all heard of Area 51, the U.S. government's top secret base in the Nevada desert. But have you ever heard of Area 52 or 53 or 54?
54? 54.
How about Tonopah Test Range or the Navy's secret base inside the Bermuda Triangle? Find out about them and more in Mac Maloney's Beyond Area 51, Mysteries of the World's Most Forbidden Places. Did Richard Nixon show Jackie Gleason a crashed alien spaceship near the swamps of Florida? Is it true that more UFOs are seen over a small Scottish village than anywhere else in the world? And is there a secret place in Russia that some people think is heaven on earth? In Mac Maloney's Beyond Area 51, you'll visit more than a dozen top secret places around the globe. The haunted forests of New Jersey. A valley in Colorado where shadows come alive and humans can fly without wings. And where's the only secret base in America that's not been visited by UFOs? You've heard Mac talk all about these places on his radio show. Now you can read all about them yourself. That's Mac Maloney's Beyond Area 51, Mysteries of the World's Most Forbidden Places. Now on sale at Amazon.
In order for the light to shine so brightly, the darkness must be present. Tune in every Monday at 10 o'clock for Dark Sun Rising on the Para-X Radio Network.
Moments that we have left, we want to talk right down to earth in a language that everybody here can easily understand.
Your source for everything paranormal, Para X.
And we're back. This is Jerry with the calling, along with Kimberly Juarez. That came all wrong. Gosh. And hey, if you're loving the show and if you missed the first half, you can actually tomorrow sometime, you can go to www.thecallingradioshow.com or you can go to YouTube, The Calling Radio Show. Please subscribe. We'd really appreciate that. Also, Para-X, man, there's like a ton of shows out there. Make sure to check them all out. Right after us, you have Exploring Paranormal Phenomenon with Shauna Kins herself. And every Tuesday night from 8 o'clock to 9 o'clock Central Standard Time, you have The Gathering with Stephanie and Heidi. You know, kind of step in and listen to it. And there's, like I said, there's tons of really good shows out there. Almost every day, there's always a good show. So check it out. Okay, so let's see now. We're on with Michael Nexum, or Hexum, I'm sorry, Michael.
Hexum.
Yeah, I know. I said
no
that
problem.
Wrong. So you were
most gonna... people know me by Pops.
Pops. Oh,
most
okay.
People know me by Pops. So.
Alrighty. It was Pops. So Coca-Cola. Dr. Pep, just kidding.
No, I was the old guy on the team I was on, so they named me Pops.
Oh, did they really? That's kind of disrespectful, I would think.
Oh, I don't care.
Yeah, I don't care.
As long as
how many times
did sir.
You? Oh, yeah, that's disrespectful. That is true. So, okay, you wanted to talk about cedar.
Yeah, a couple of things I want to talk about, and one thing I get a lot of emails on, but yeah, the cedars, we talked about the wintertime being in a tamarack. Cedars, primarily, I've got a lot of knots coming out of cedar swamps. And from my own experience with that is there's no bugs. For whatever reason, you have very few bugs coming out of the cedar. Something about the trees or whatever that kind of deters bugs. So it makes sense that they're going to be in the cedars primarily in the hot summer months. So.
Yeah,
that's what I want to touch base on. And another thing, I get people emailing me. You know, we went up and we did this and did that. And they're talking to me in all this science mumble jumble. I'm not a science person.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a big problem we have with a lot of researchers I see on these sites is a lot of them are book smart and they're movie smart. And I actually know some people, friends of mine, that are the same way. They have no experience really in the woods. Mm-hmm. They've never, you know, walked in an area that was real dense and remote. They don't know animal signs. They don't know a lot of things. And right away, you know, they get upset because they can't find anything. Well, right. A lot of them don't build their campsites more than 10 feet from their vehicles. So, I mean, I've offered to take people out and train them in. And I'm still thinking about that. Take, you know, a few people out at a time with me and get them used to the woods, finding their way, you know, in the woods without a compass type of deal and different animal signs and stuff like that. But yeah, next question.
Yeah, definitely cedar oil is a deterrent for bugs, which is really awesome. I like that. Let's see now. There was another one here in the... your thoughts on it. You don't have to elaborate on it if you don't want to. But what do you think about the somebody in the chat rooms asking about the Patterson-Gimlin film? You know, true or false?
I really don't know what to make of it. My own deal is, okay, this creature has breasts. Why would they go through all the trouble of putting breasts on a Bigfoot? You know, they would have just simply made a costume. And I actually got to see the Iceman back in the 70s, all right? And what I believe what I seen was real, because you couldn't, back in that time, you couldn't make stuff that good. Mm-hmm. Hollywood could not come up with costumes and that good to fake out people like they can now. But, yeah, I don't know. I'm not saying I believe it or I don't believe it. It's very interesting to watch, but one of the things that have always intrigued me is why did they put, female body parts on this thing? They could have just very easily had somebody in a costume without the body parts or whatever. So
that's true.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. You know, a lot of people say that, when it comes to that time, was it 1957?
Mm-hmm. I think
or something like that.
Yeah. Oh, no, 67 was a Gimlin. I believe it was 67 when they filmed the Patterson-Gimlin.
Right, but they also had costumes that people believed, vampire. People really believed mm-hmm. that was real, that they're seeing. The creature from mm-hmm. the Black Lagoon, people really thought that was 100% real. You know, and so, yeah. You know, could they have made something? They really could have, because it just seems awful funny that is the only film that was ever shown that some people believe it is. Now that they put it into colorized on 4K, it's a big difference mm-hmm. because it really shows that, you know, that it, in my eyes, it shows that it's fraudulent, you know, because of...
Yeah, I don't know.
The way things move. Have you seen the colored version yet?
No, I haven't.
If you go to YouTube or something and look for 4K colorized Gimlin or Patterson-Gimlin film, and mm-hmm. you're going to be amazed. You're going to then think twice about it, you know, that is something like that. Yeah. But I mean, you know, everybody's got opinions, you know, which is, you know, that's what makes us abnormal, normal. So that's what makes us, you know, people. I just don't think it's real. I mean, that's just like some people believe in remote viewing, you know, that they can sit back and remote view Bigfoot and know exactly where it's at. And then go chasing mm-hmm. them, or actually not really even chase them and stuff like that. But that's not, if you're going to go out and try to find Bigfoot, you need to go out there, right? It's plain and simple. Mm-hmm. There's no sitting back on a computer saying, well, I think he's here or she's here, you know. And, you know, also a lot of people, too, think that Bigfoot and UFOs are the same. but I just don't see it, and I don't see a connection.
No.
And I don't know, really, you know, a lot of people believe there's no such thing. And since I'm going to be on my soapbox for a moment, what do you think about Reamer being the Bigfoot capital of Minnesota? Do you think it should be Reamer, or do you think it should be Bena?
I got to say, with Reamer, I had that third sighting was right out of Reamer. That's with that old gas and no brakes. Mm-hmm. And I've been out on a couple other outings in the Reamer area where we've gotten tree knocks and other things going on. So I do believe they're in there. Yes, I do believe
right
that the Reamer area has them. But so do I up here. You know, it's they're all right over in Minnesota. I mean,
Well, there's actually
Reamer, yeah. I mean,
oh, I'm sorry.
I've had good luck in Reamer.
Gotcha.
The only thing I don't like about that area is you got a lot of people and campers, so you're not getting remote. I like to be out where there's no people.
Right.
So you're not getting any background noise from anything else, or especially like around hunting season. I'm done at hunting season because you got hunters in the woods. So if you do a tree knock, chances are they're going to respond with a tree knock. So I just stay out of the woods.
Yeah. And
no, Reamer, I'd say, yeah, they're credible. They got something going on there, definitely.
Yeah, I did a little checking on Bigfoot sightings between Reamer and Bena. And Bena actually has a couple more sightings than what Reamer does. I just think it's Reamer jumped on it a little bit faster than what Bena would have. And Bena, I don't know why, but it's such a it's so much older than what Reamer is. And I think it would have been Reamer being a little bit bigger. I think that, you know, it was a good fit for right there, you know, itself. Yeah. And did you go there last year?
I was in and out of that area with a group of people. Did a few overnights. They had the Bigfoot Days in Reamer, so we were there and pretty much answering questions for people. People wanted me to do my mumble talk, so taping
oh,
me
no.
do the mumble talk, and I don't know if you ever heard that, but
no, what's your mumble
that
talk?
That was the hit of the whole all gas and no brakes with the mumble talk that I did. So they actually did, I guess they did a rap song with my voice on that.
Really?
I haven't heard that yet. But,
oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. Not nice.
And, another old man speaks perfect Bigfoot. I've heard that, and it's me doing my mumble talk. And what I heard that day out in the woods was two of them vocalizing, and it was just like a like that. That's what I heard. And I talked to a friend of mine, Ron Moorhead, and he was at the conference 2 years ago in Grand Rapids, Minnesota, and I did that for him. And he said he actually had some audio of the same sound.
Yep.
And actually, he's got a lot of different sounds. Ron's a cool guy. I like him.
Who is this?
Ron Moorhead.
Ron Moorhead.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I know who he is. We're friends on Facebook.
Yeah.
I'll be darned.
And Cliff is a friend of mine, and Bobo. Mm-hmm. Matt Moneymaker, I spent the night out in the woods. I got a bunch of people. Dr. Meldrum, I know him pretty good. But yeah, Ron Moorhead, he's a pretty good guy. He knows all these different sounds and that. And he could definitely told me what I heard. And he said, yeah, he heard the same thing. So that mumbling fox.
Mm-hmm.
So in some of the sounds that you hear, can't some of them be, you know, kind of dismissed as animal sounds? You know, be it that they're in distress or... you know, or something like that, that, you know, somebody might not always hear. They, you know, because like rabbits, I mean, you wouldn't think a rabbit makes that kind of odd sound. But when a rabbit is ultra stressed or is about to be crunched down on and stuff, they can sound like babies crying.
Yep. I can actually mimic that.
Do it.
I used to do that years ago to call wolves in. And actually, I can do a wolf call that sounds just like a real wolf. I'm not going to do one on air right now. But,
come on.
No. Probably blow out the meters over there. But anyhow, you know, that's where I get back to. There's a lot of people out there that are doing Bigfoot outings and that, and they really, you know, they're city people. Not that there's anything wrong with city people, but they have really no idea what they're doing out in the woods.
Right.
So, yeah, I grew up, I know it, within the last years we've had mountain lions roaming up here now, and I've heard them in the morning as a real screaming noise with the mountain lions. And rabbits, yeah, they'll make a squealing noise. I actually have a game call that will mimic that. In fact, I'm going to bring one with me. I'm going to go out on an overnight in about 2 weeks. I got an area where I had two eyewitnesses see these creatures. The only way in there is by four-wheeler. There's no way you could walk in there or drive a vehicle in there.
Right.
And I'm going to go in there. My youngest boy is going to go with me and another friend of mine. And we're going to go in there and spend the night. And I plan on using this rabbit squealer because if anything, it might bring in some coyotes or whatever, which would be cool, or wolves coming in.
Mm-hmm.
But what's to say that Bigfoot doesn't hear this distress call and say, oh, easy dinner, let's go and check it out. You
know? Right.
But something I've been toying with, I want to kind of experiment with. But there again, you know, I know, Jerry, you've been a woodsman your whole life and everything, and you can get out in the woods, you can kind of distinguish what's going on with different bird sounds, what's going on. A deer will make a whistling noise when they're distressed. Sounds like somebody whistling. There's different noises bears will make. You know, and that's just something you have to know. And the only way you know that is by spending time in the woods.
Yeah, that's
true. I'm 65 years old. I've spent most of my life in the woods.
Right.
You know, I went deer hunting for the first time many, many years ago. And I had this beautiful shotgun, and we were up by Hackensack, and there was a buck. And my dad was like, take it, it's yours. So shot once, it went across its back, and it actually started coming right for us. And, I mean, directly at me, and it's eyes and me met. And I love animals, man, you know. So I took a second shot it off in the shoulder, and it went down. And it was making a sound I never thought any kind of deer could ever make. It was a panic pain sound. And
a little scream, actually.
Yeah, it was horrifying. And my dad gave me his knife and said, you know, go cut his throat. And I'm like, no. And I had a .44 Magnum.
No, you don't want to do it. You don't want to do that.
I know.
Yeah.
Well, that's what you know. We from Bemidji, and you know that's the way you did it. That's the way they wanted you to do it, you know. But I shot it, and then Dad's like, you know, here I'm going to show you how to gut it, and I'm like, you know, this just goes to show you that everybody in my family is a hunter. I guess I'm not, because I was like, nope, ain't going to happen, Dad. Sorry. He goes, then you can walk home. Okay, I'm walking, and I did. Middle of wintertime, I walked about 6-7 miles home.
Wow.
And I will never, and that stayed with me for a long time, because, I mean, if you don't know the sound that an animal can make in such pain, you know what a human can make in such pain.
Right.
You know, and, you know, it's really horrifying. So on some of these sounds that people think it's Bigfoot and everything, it could be an animal, or could it be a Bigfoot making that sound to attract others?
Mimicking it.
Yeah, you just never know.
As much time as I spent in the woods all my life, I've heard sounds that I've never, ever heard before. And so I guess, okay, what was that? I've never heard. It's like that mumble talk thing. And, but like I say, you know, that goes with experience. You spend, you know, 50 some years of your life out in the woods and, you know, hunting and doing stuff with your dad. And you get to learn, you know, what it's like to be out in the woods. You get to learn sign and everything else.
Right.
And what's really cool is you ever heard a moose in the morning bellering? They do their love song, mating.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
That is really cool to listen to.
They're loud. I've heard it. They're loud.
Moose will actually, they'll actually follow you in the woods.
Oh, really?
Because they're curious. Okay. I've been followed a couple of times by a moose. The reason I knew that is I could see it. And I'm getting a little nervous. I was actually treed by one.
Oh.
Luckily, there was a deer stand. I could get up, and the thing walked down the stand for half an hour and then left. And I'm going, great, now I got to get out of here. Another interesting thing I found, too, I was walking a trail that goes to this lake. Some of the cedars in there are so old that the branches are actually bent like elbows. Mm-hmm. What a lot of people don't understand is Native Americans did that so they had a line of sight to a body of water. And you'll walk 100 yards and find another tree with a bent, you know, branch on it. Looks like an elbow, and it's pointing in a direction that you want to go.
Okay.
But I was back in that area. I was following this line of trees, and this is a few years ago. There was a tree stump, and I want to say it was about probably a good 4.5 feet up in the air where it broke off. In the middle of the stump was a pile of poop, and it wasn't animal. Wolves will have hair in it from eating, you know, different things. You can tell what wolf droppings. And this was the size of a human that he would do. And I just stood there and I looked at it and I go, okay, even if somebody wanted to prank you, what are the odds you'd find this where I was walking? And then number two, how in the heck would you get up in here that high to go to the bathroom on top of this stump?
Right.
And I wish I would have had I carry a sample kit for when I'm out in the woods if I find hair in that. I wish I would have had something like that with me. I would have taken a DNA sample and put it in brought it in somewhere and had it checked. I was just really curious, but that's about the weirdest thing I've ever seen.
Right. Wow. Well, you know, my grandfather would have said, that's what socks are for. I won't go into the story.
Yeah. Birch bark works better.
Oh, yeah. That's true. But, yeah, no, I agree. I mean, if you're in the woods a lot and stuff, you should be carrying, you know, something to put all your evidence, you know, collecting of evidence in. You should always carry a small shovel just in case somebody was to step in mud and get stuck. Stephanie Langer.
Mm-hmm.
And don't forget your camera, because there's always somebody to film something.
No. Well, that's true.
I've got some good stories on that, too. I could tell you some stories of people getting stuck.
Right?
Oh, yeah.
Yep, that's true. So, Michael,
yeah,
what do you...
Sterile...
Go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say, I have a sterile kit today. It's sterile and everything, and then just for samples. But, yeah, what were you going to ask me?
Michael, what do you think about other cryptids up in northern Minnesota? What do you think, like the dog man and all that?
I've never seen one.
Okay.
But there again, it's like UFOs. I've never seen them. I do believe they could exist.
Mm-hmm.
I probably would have a hard time with Bigfoot if I hadn't seen one from 20 feet away from me. And it stared me in the eyes. I stared it in the eyes and it walked off. And so I always tell people who are critics, I know what I know, I've seen what I've seen, and I have nothing to prove to anybody.
Right.
But
right.
You never know. It could be some off breed of a wolf. Mm-hmm. We got a new breed of wolf up here that I seen 4 years ago. It's a cross between a timber wolf and a coyote.
They look
like a timber wolf, but they're the size of a coyote. So I was talking to some people and they said, yeah, they named them a coy wolf.
Oh, wow.
Are you serious?
The DNR. Yeah, I'm serious. DNR says they don't exist. Well, they told me that 8 years ago, mountain lions.
Uh-huh.
And I said, really? And so I did a kind of a story on mountain lions. And within a couple of years ago, they now admit that we have mountain lions in Minnesota. But they're non-breeding pairs. I said, what, they're all males? They're all females? I go, give me a break.
Right.
You know,
yeah.
That's hogwash. I mean, we have animals up here that, we had grizzly bears range up here. We had elk, caribou.
Mm-hmm.
The mountain lions are just starting to come back. They were all killed off or driven out of here by the trappers and the logging industry back in the 1800s. But, yeah, getting back to this dog man, who's to say it's not a crossbreed between something?
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
You know, I'm sorry to interrupt. When you were saying about all these different things that are coming up and the DNR saying there's no such thing, we did an investigation up north. This is quite a long time ago. And there was actually cougar up there, mountain lion.
Yes.
And there's there's been quite a few have been reported. There's been even two of them. I think one is like northwestern Minnesota. It was hit by a car, 130-pound female. And up northern Minnesota, it was about 120-pound male that was also hit by a car. So they're definitely around there. And, you know, the oddest animals, I mean, like, how long has it been now that we've had possum around here? You know, it's – and I know 7 years ago I brought a friend of mine to St. Croix Falls, St. Croix River. And as we were pulling into this boat launch where he was going to launch his canoe at, was a six-foot rattlesnake.
Yeah,
and we have them up there now.
Yep.
And just recently, a friend of mine showed me a picture, and I'm like, "That's a cobra." And she goes, "No, they're like a cobra. They are not venomous. No, not a bull snake. I can't remember what she called it, but they're here in Minnesota, mostly in the Brainerd area and stuff. And they have a hood that come up, and it's." A lot of people, DNR and stuff like that, I mean, they get excited when they find them because they're very rare to find.
You're not saying like a python type.
No, 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 no. They're about maybe 6 to 8 feet long, but they have a hood to them. They look just like a cobra, and they're not poisonous. They just, you know, number one, will scare the bejeebs out of you, and they're, you know, it's pretty crazy, but... yeah, there's all sorts of different animals around that never were here before. And climate change, you know, pretty soon we might even have elephants up there in the woods that we never knew were there, you know?
Yeah, you don't know. You don't know. But, yeah, you talk about rattlesnakes. I was down by Brownsville, Minnesota, about 30 years ago, and I was doing a turkey hunt. And a friend of mine had property along the river down there in Brownsville. And it was kind of a chilly morning. I went up and got on a rock pile. I was sitting on a rock pile waiting for the sun to come up. And I noticed the ground moving below me. And when I looked down, when it got light enough to see, it was rattlesnakes. And I thought I was seeing things. But they weren't big like they are out west. They were smaller. But, yeah, they're just, as, you know, venomous. And, so, yeah, they do. They're down around the St. Croix River. You can find them down there in southern Minnesota, even up around the Twin Cities in the river.
Yeah. Well, hold tight here. We are at the end of the show, Michael. I so appreciate you coming on.
It went by quick.
It went by very quick. My gosh.
Well, you get me going. I mean, I could talk for 4 hours.
I can listen to you for 4 hours.
I know.
Me too.
This has been an exciting show.
I'm going to start a podcast. Not a podcast, but a YouTube site. I'm going to get one going. I plan on doing some filming.
Nice.
You should.
So that's in the works.
Excellent. Well, I'll get a hold of you in the next couple of days here. There's a couple other things I want to talk about. But thank you so much for coming on. Thank you, Sarge.
Well, thank you.
Thank you. And thank you, Para X. Thank you, Sarge. And for the troops out there listening, we appreciate you very much.
Thank you.
And be safe. Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Good night.